Welcome to another episode of the Big J and Little J Show, where we'll be recapping Duke's win at PNC Arena against NC State, a 79-64 win, Connor. The last time we talked is coming off Duke's loss against Wake Forest, but Duke seemed to bounce back to 3-0 week for Duke. A couple of 25-point wins and a 15-point win last night at NC State.
Yeah, it's if my math is correct here and off the top of my head, it's the second time they've won three games in a six-day stretch. They had the when was it earlier? It was Notre Dame, BC, and then the home game against Wake was a Wednesday, Saturday, Monday swing. You can look at it that way. You can also look at it as this was the third and obviously final Saturday to Monday swing of the season. Duke swept all three of those. They went Saturday to Monday when they had the tight win against Clemson, and then I thought they were going to go up and lay an egg at Virginia Tech like they always do, and they won by 10. They had the 15-point win over BC, and then 2 days later turned around and beat Wake Forest. And then yesterday came off of a 25-point dismantling of Virginia and went to PNC and spotted them. Was it 9-0? I know it was 7-0 when John called the timeout. State got another bucket in there.
I'm pretty sure it was 9-0.
Yeah, I haven't pulled out my yellow legal pad yet. But, they spotted them a 9-0 start and outscored them by 24 the rest of the way.
Yeah, I mean, this Duke team's not rattled, man. They're not rattled. And that's been the most impressive thing is we're expecting letdown somewhere. Like, I remember the Virginia Tech game, going to Virginia Tech. We thought that would be a letdown. That was Duke's best performance leading up to that standpoint of the season. And then there's the yellow notepad for Connor. And then they had the road test against Florida State, Miami, and Wake. And you did say that Duke was going to lose one of those. You thought it would be Wake Forest. Duke did lose to Wake Forest. But they still played well, like we talked about. And then this game, like, look, Duke has lost six of our last nine leading into this game at PNC, so it's a right to feel uneasy regardless of State's record. And it's funny, the graphic that I saw was NC State's 3-0 against Duke at PNC under Keats when the attendance is more than 25 people, because the 1 year that he lost was Duke was COVID. That's one of my favorites. I should have screenshotted that. That's one of my favorite tidbits is, well, NC State's 3-0 when there's a crowd. The one loss was 25 people in the stands.
That's well done. I didn't know where you were going with that. When you started saying 25, I thought you were going 25,000, and I was like, the building holds 19. People. It holds 19,700. But yeah.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, we'll throw a little dirt on the Wolfpack there. It was kind of a crowd that wanted to get into the game. It certainly helped that they scored the first 9 points. I wrote this in the preview that was illustrated. Like, I was so curious what the crowd temperature was going to be, just because they're in such a state of plateauing under Kevin Keats. And it doesn't really seem like the ceiling is as high as it should be for a team with two national championships. So I was kind of on guard if Duke had gotten out to a really good start, if it was going to turn, if the anger toward Duke was going to turn into anger toward their own bench and toward their own coach. But really wasn't any of that. The only real notable thing about the crowd was they all started filing out about 3.5 minutes left, 2.5. And somewhere in there toward the end of the game, you could hear a little bit of a "Let's go Duke" chant.
Yeah, I mean, that's always good to hear when you're a Duke fan. But NC State, like, Keats, obviously, you know, I do have, like, Keats is the most famous alum of my college, Ferrum College.
And other than you. Always,
huh?
Other than you.
Yeah, other than me and Jim Grobe. And
Groby.
And so I always take pride in Keats, like, came from Ferrum. And he did great things at UNC Wilmington. Obviously, he has a track record being a successful coach other places. So it's been tough. It's unfortunate for him at State, because also, like, with context of Keats, like, inevitably he probably will be let go after this season. But he was one person away, one recruit away, it seemed like, the last 3 years. And the one this year is Rob Dillingham, who was committed to NC State, and he is Kentucky's best player. And that hurts for me, to me, for him, because, I mean, that guy would completely flip this whole season around for NC State.
Yeah, I just I don't know if this is the way it should be or if this is fair, but it seems like at some point you shouldn't get credit for all of your none and done recruits. Like, they keep getting verbals and getting guys in the boat with, and then you go talk to somebody a month after they commit, and it's just like, yeah, he's still looking around, he's still shopping, he's looking for a better offer, he's going to visit this place or that place. I mean, it's a great hypothetical, but, you know, what do I say the two things that losers do?
Yeah, you what ifs are basically one of them.
Yeah. Losers bitch about refs and live in hypotheticals.
And I live in hypotheticals. So I fit that narrative, Connor. As a Duke football fan, I fit that narrative.
I'm sorry.
It's okay. I accept
it. I do it too.
But okay. Let's go back before we deep dive into the NC State game. Let's recap the week that it was for Duke. So against Louisville, they won by 25. Cruz, obviously, there's sloppiness in parts of the game. But that's what happens when you look. It's what happens in college basketball. You still win by 25. I don't care much about like the Spurs that Duke looked sloppy, and they won by 25. 10 guys played and 9 guys scored.
Yeah, look, Louisville's not the train wreck that their record indicates. They have talent. It's a bigger indictment of that coaching staff that they have the talent that they have, and they're still in dead effing last in the ACC, and they're going to be there. They have no hope. That book is sealed. There is going to be at least one opening in the ACC, and it's going to be Louisville. I don't know about NC State. It might be a year away from that one. But, yeah, I mean, I don't know what else you would want out of Duke other than a 25-point win. I think the 25-point win even moved them down in the net, as silly as that is, because they didn't win by 50. But you're not going to run it up on a team that, you know, they have some talent, and like when they have a coaching change and when those guys hit the portal and you see the teams that want some of the players that are in the portal for them that aren't pursuing pro careers, you'll know that they're not the same talent devoid team that they were last year. Like last year was just an awful team, awful roster construction. Everything about that was terrible. That's not this year. They have talent. They're just poorly coached. And yeah. Duke did exactly what they needed to do in that game.
Now, are you saying poorly coached because you cover Wake Forest and Danny Manning is now on that staff?
I'm glad you brought up him as the first assistant and not Nolan, because I'm not trying to tell everybody that Nolan Smith is a terrible assistant coach. But, I mean, look, it's just – it's top down.
Crazy. That zone was one of the worst zones I've ever seen. And I clipped it on my video breakdowns. Please look at my YouTube at JMan_ where I break down the game. But that zone was insane.
You know, it's interesting because I didn't tell you this on Twitter or anything. And we haven't texted about it. Wake actually had a little bit of success in Danny's last year or two with a matchup zone that I referred to as an amoeba defense, because you could never tell whether it was a 3-2 or a 2-3. And I think that's probably what it was. I think it's just all the fundamentals of playing zone. Like, hey, you learn this when you're 10 years old. If you're in a zone, have your hands up and trap. They did not do.
I mean, I've never seen a zone where the middle guy is always wide open. Like, yeah. No guys beside of him, behind him. Filipowski just could catch and turn and go to the rim every time if he wanted to. And that was just mind-boggling.
Yeah, and I think that some things probably got lost in translation. But
oh yeah,
I'd be really curious to – if I had a better relationship with Danny, I could text him and say, hey, were you trying to put in the zone that you had in the last couple of years at Wake? Because, like, as bad as Wake's defenses were, there are published stories with my name on them saying that Wake Forest had found a little success in playing a zone that was kind of unidentified. Like, it was I should have slapped some like UFO terms on there, like unidentified zone defense.
to really put it all in perspective, Connor, three starters for Duke had double digits that game. It was Roach with 19, Mitchell 17, McCain 14. The two starters that did not was Filipowski, who had 9 points and 6 assists, and Tyrese Proctor had 8 points and 7 assists. So Duke was really, when they weren't scoring in double figures players, then they were passing the ball around, and it showed in the stat sheet.
Yeah, that was that the 23 assists on 32 field goals game?
I don't have it in front of me, but based off of those two guys, I'll go out on a limb and say yes.
I think it was. That ties Duke's high in assist rate on the season. I think 23 of 32 is 71.4%, and the only other game.
Crazy, which is crazy.
They had the same number against either Bucknell or LaSalle, one of those two Blue Devil
classic. Wins.
The Blue Devil classic games. Yeah. We're not going to Maui or the Bahamas or anywhere like that. We're just going to have our own MTE event. Highest against an ACC team, highest against a power conference team of the year. And I've dove into the numbers for you. Like Duke is 17-0 when that assist rate is above 50%. They're 7-6 when it's 50% or lower. It's not a prerequisite to have a high assist number, and we saw that like last night. We'll talk about. Yeah, they did not have a good assist rate last night because they just kept missing open shots. But when that assist rate climbs, it usually spells really good things for this team.
Yeah, I have that in my notes. I want you to go over that when we go over the NC State game. And the last thing we'll touch base on is the Virginia game. I mean, I think this was Filipowski's best offensive performance of the season, just efficiency wise, 21 points on 9 of 14. Proctor's really stepped up, which we'll go into him in this game as well, but 15 points, 4 rebounds, 5 assists. And then the three bigs, Sean Stewart, TJ Power, Ryan Young, played double-digit minutes off the bench against Virginia, which you would not have – nobody would have had that on their bingo card probably a month ago. Like, obviously, when Foster went down, I'm going to give TJ Power his flowers too in a second, that they've stepped up very well in just in a collaborative effort against – ACC opponents and have held their own. And look, it's not last night with Sean Stewart and them, like, yeah, they're in the stat sheet, but TJ Power, he's not doing anything special, but he's doing his job. And that's the thing, make minimal mistakes and play double digit minutes, which he's had three straight games of double digit minutes, Connor, and all three games, you shake your head like that, but all three games positive plus minus.
I'm only shaking my head because as soon as you say make minimal mistakes, I'm remembering Tyrese Proctor burning a timeout last night, less than 8 minutes into the game. It's Duke's second timeout because John had to call a timeout when they were up a touchdown and bless them out for their effort. And Tyrese calls the second timeout on a baseline out of bounds. Look, I'm so far away at NC State. Like, we're up in the hockey press box. There's nobody sitting higher than us. But I have a good line of sight to Duke's bench. It's really the best line of sight. Sometimes it's better than Cameron because you got people in front of you in Cameron. That last night, you can just see right down into it.
Yeah.
John let two players have it for calling that timeout and not being able to inbound the ball on a simple blob. And one of them was the guy you just said makes minimal mistakes.
It's a minimal mistake.
Again, like, you can make mistakes. Yeah. John's got – they've got faith. They've got more faith in TJ than they have any time really in the first 25 games, right?
Yeah. Like, yeah.
He's playing minutes. If you want to – again, if you want to live in the hypotheticals and say he wouldn't be playing minutes without Caleb Foster's injury, then I don't know if there's much of an argument against that. But the reality is Caleb Foster's out. Like, he's still in a walking boot and a knee rover. And – That's where they are right now. And I think it's really telling that you go down the three guys that played double-digit minutes, TJ, Ryan Young, and Sean Stewart. Remember when Jeremy Roach has been hurt, when Tyrese Proctor missed games? It was a lot of Jalen Blake's in there. Like, it was Mr. Chaos. You never know what you're going to get, but it's always going to be hustle and effort. I think he had a DNP last night. He didn't get in there very much against Virginia.
They played 1 minute or 2 minutes against either or Virginia or Louisville.
Yeah, there's been a shift there where John feels more confident in the bigger guys off the bench than trying to shoehorn a three-guard lineup out there without having three of your top four guards.
I'm glad you bring that up, Connor. I'm sorry to cut you off. I'm glad you bring that up because what he has done with those three guys, they've played together. Or if Ryan Young hasn't played with him, it's been Flip, Sean Stewart, and TJ Power on the court together. And what I've seen is Sean Stewart can guard the wing. And so that's taken away. That's what Blake's did. And Sean Stewart does a fantastic job of guarding other guards, like surprisingly really good at it. But then on the offensive end, he is running the four and TJ Power is playing the wing. And we saw that last night against NC State. Sean Stewart gets the offensive rebound, and who's in the corner is TJ Power's 1-3 they hit in the game, but he's out there as the three and kick it out. And it was a dagger three by Duke. So it's like they interchange. One's playing the post on defense and one side, then he's flipped playing the wing and vice versa. And honestly, it looks fantastic. Like Duke's bench looks legit these last three games.
Yeah. And that's where you, I mean, you get confidence because Jeremy Roach has been playing the same way all year, basically, other than when he's been banged up. You get confidence because anytime Jared McCain hits one shot, you feel like the next four or five are going to come in the next 5 minutes. You get confidence because Kyle Filipowski is one of the most talented players in the country, and Tyrese Proctor is coming on. Where you really get confidence in this team is down the line. Like when John goes to the bench and there's not as much of a drop off, or you're getting hustle and effort offensive rebounds out of Ryan Young and Sean Stewart and TJ Power stretching the floor. And he's only got to give you the one. Like he's just got to hit. He's just got to keep defenses honest and put the thought into their head that they can't leave him alone. I mean, that's, you know, you go to the old adage, you're only strong as your weakest link. Like it sounds harsh. I'm not saying like any of those guys are the weakest link.
Right.
Maliciously, but like, that's just the reality. And, you know, I'm thinking back to the team 2 years ago that was in the Final Four. Like that was as good of a 1-6 as anybody in the country had. But your bench was Theo John and Joey Baker.
Yeah. No, you're not wrong. You're not wrong. But I do think they have really – they impact the game so well in other aspects besides scoring the basketball. I know that Charles Stewart did score the basketball last night, but we'll get into that. The rebounding and defense, just the little things, the intangibles that they bring the last – week has been impressive. But one guy we talked about, obviously Foster's absence, Proctor has really stepped up in his absence a lot. And he was the only one that scored in the first half of the game against NC State. But I was going to say he has played 30 minutes or more in four straight games. He played 29 minutes against Virginia, but he would have played more if it wasn't a blowout. Like he played 29 minutes, but I'm rounding it up. Played 30 minutes in four straight games, including all 40 minutes last night at NC State. Like that's an underrated thing about Proctor. And for perspective, the last time he played more than 30 minutes in a game, Connor, was at Virginia Tech on January 29th. So,
and you saw who his primary defensive assignment was last night too.
Yes, DJ Horn.
Yeah, the guy averaging like 22.5 points a game over their last 10, and who I think is like the team captain of the all ACC villains team along with Blake Henson. So that was more impressive to me than hitting three threes in the first half, the little floater in the lane, John credited as kind of getting Duke going and being a really important bucket, that first one to avoid another.
Right, yeah. Off the right foot.
Yeah. Avoid another double digit deficit to start a game in that building. He's, you see it in spurts, and you know, you're hesitant because it's come in spurts this year and then it's stopped. So I'm still a little hesitant there, but I think the most impressive thing is defensively, he looks like he is where he was at the end of last year, which was you're going to stick him on the opponent's best guard and feel really good about shutting them down.
Yeah. I mean, he only had 11 points last night, but I think all 11 came in the first half. And I think that though he was aggressive in the first half, Duke didn't need him, obviously. In the second half, Duke ran away, but it was him, like Shire said, that bucket got Duke going. But there were the three threes he hit Jared McCain's threes and Roach's threes were nowhere close in the first half. Roach had almost a straight on look. They hit the right side of the padding. And I'm like, how the hell did you miss it that bad? And, but Proctor was the guy that hit the dagger threes. Like he got Duke going, and then he had a couple assists as well. And I think he sneakily was the MVP last night because of the first half. I mean, he had a third of the team's points, and then he played all 40 minutes and locked up NC State's best player. I know DJ Burns went crazy.
No, you don't have to make any.
DJ Horn's our best player.
Yeah. It's not the offensive lineman that plays center for them.
Yeah, I mean, he's special too, but obviously very one-dimensional, and we'll get down to that too. But, yeah, Proctor stopped DJ Horn. I want to keep saying DJ Burns, DJ Horn, and that was very impressive.
Just say DJ, and we'll know which one you're talking about. Proctor was matched. Like, they got Proctor on some switches, and he was matched up against DJ Burns, and it was like,
mouse in the house.
There's like three Tyrese Proctors that are needed to guard one DJ Burns.
People forget he was Big South Freshman of the Year and then Big South Player of the Year at Winthrop. Can you imagine trying to guard him as a Big South big man? Because, obviously, Phil Pasty's 7'2", 245, and Sean Stewart is a strong specimen for Duke, and he was throwing him around like a rag doll in the post.
It's impressive for a guy who's listed at 275 pounds.
Yeah. Very. You said
I heard about that being joked about on the broadcast last night, so I guess I'm going to joke about it here a little bit. Just a little bit.
The one thing I was going to say, too, with Burns, obviously he had 27, but he only had 5 rebounds. And the one knock on him is if he's not scoring, he can't play defense, and he averages less than 4 rebounds a game for NC State. And Duke had 12 offensive rebounds in the first half, Connor, and NC State had 12 total rebounds. And what I loved most about that was – Flip got in foul trouble early, only played 4 minutes. Ryan Young comes in and gets 4 offensive rebounds alone in the first half. Like that.
And then gets in foul trouble too.
Yeah, but I mean that he actually had really good success against DJ Burns defensively. Like he made him settle for tough looks, a couple fadeaways that didn't go in. But yeah, he got called for a couple ticky. I thought they were ticky tack in terms of how physical the referees were letting DJ Burns initiate contact. And not letting the defender like get any sort of lick back, I was like, you gotta let both go each way.
Yeah, well, that's where you pay attention to the pregame ref discussion because Ayers, Groover, and Doug Shows are going to let you play. Like those are three of the refs that they've all been to multiple Final Fours. They're going to let you play through a lot of stuff. And last night, watching Ryan Young play defense against DJ Burns was a good reminder that Ryan Young banged in the Big Ten for 1 year as a redshirt player and then 3 years as a rotational guy for Northwestern. Like, he's not it's a different style of basketball in that league, and it's really gritty and grimy when you get into the post. That was a good reminder that he was there. And that was a good reminder that, you know, we're only, about 16 months removed from him having to guard Zach Edey.
Yeah. I mean, that's a great point. And he just impresses me because he does have a knack for the ball for a guy that plays below the rim. I've talked about it on here all the time, but he really does just get rebounds when he doesn't elevate like Sean Stewart does.
He's smart and he knows positioning. And yep. Anybody that's played basketball knows that rebounding is not just height and jump ability. It's positioning and it's anticipation. And he is so good at those things that he makes up for the areas where he lacks. And that's why it's been silly for the last 4 months for people to say Sean Stewart should take all of Ryan Young's minutes. Ryan Young should never play. Ryan Young should just show up in sweaters and look good on the pregame fit tweets and all that stuff. Like, that's so dumb because he does bring something to the table. He is limited. Like, nobody has ever said he's not limited. But yeah,
he comes off the bench for a reason. Of course he's limited.
Yes. But the things that he does well, this team needs and gets out of him most of the time. They don't need him picking up a loose ball foul 70 feet from the basket like he did for the second one 5 minutes left in the first half.
But his hustle play when Duke had that slow start, he comes in and dives for a loose ball, and it goes all the way out of bounds, and there's 5 seconds left on the shot clock for State. Like, he didn't get the possession, but then he initially sets the tone coming in. Like, I'm going after every ball. And then that really did give Duke a personality on the floor when they were lost.
Yeah, all those dives, I should have thought, you know, you never think to make notes about that kind of stuff. I really wish I had started making notes about that in the yellow legal pad, because after John called that early timeout, about 3 minutes into the game, 2.5 minutes into the game, it was like body on the floor, body on the floor, body on, like it was constant diving. It was a pretty clear message.
They're clean dives. I want to make that on record, because a lot of basketball now loves to talk about like diving plays. Not last night's game, Connor. I'm just saying in general, when guy dives for a ball, like, oh, he's going for his legs. No. Brian Young, clean dives, and I just want to shout him out for his hustle plays that he does on a daily basis, a game basis.
Yeah, you're going to get those out of him every game. I wasn't aware that basketball Twitter was into the diving.
Oh yeah, I'm deep into those. I'm deep into basketball Twitter of bad takes. So I had to go that on record.
Good. Keep me honest.
I want to say Duke finished with 19 offensive rebounds, Connor. And coming into this game, Duke had double-digit rebounds on 4 of the last 5. The one game they didn't was Wake, but they still shot like 55% from the field. I think they had 8 offensive rebounds that game. But everybody in the NC State game, Connor, had an offensive rebound except for Tyrese Proctor for Duke. And Mark Mitchell, Sean Stewart, and Ryan Young all had 4 offensive rebounds each. That's my favorite stat of the year. That's incredible.
Did you get an answer to your question on Twitter?
No. Duke had more offensive rebounds than defensive?
Yeah, you don't know when the last time that was?
No, go ahead and tell me it was like last game.
Oh, we can have some fun with this. It wasn't this year.
Okay.
It wasn't last year.
That's good. Okay, I'm not an idiot. I was just like, if you're going to tell me it was like the Virginia game, I'm going to immediately end the show.
No, I would have quote tweeted that just to make you look silly in front of the audience on Twitter. It was the first game John Shire coached.
Oh wow, that's a cool stat. That is a cool stat.
But it wasn't last year.
Oh, it was the one Kay was sick.
Yeah, the Boston College game on January 6th, 2021. There was nothing else going on in the world that day.
Where were you on January 6th, Connor?
Yeah, I was sitting in my office, literally on the phone with somebody at another newspaper trying to gauge whether I was going to apply to his newspaper or not. And then we talked for 15 to 20 minutes and hung up, and we ended it with like, oh, wow, do you have CNN on? Or like, guess I should pay attention to this.
For the record, Connor is a Baltimore Orioles fan, so I think he was around that area on January 6th, but I just can't place it.
No, I was here in K-Vegas.
But that is a crazy stat that Shire was his first game when he was the interim head coach against, you said Boston College, right?
Yeah, he filled in for K twice before taking over the job. One was that COVID season when Duke was 13-11, and it was the like fighting Matt Hurts and Jeremy Roach's freshman year. Very forgettable season. I think that was like a 1-point home win against BC. And then John's other game that he filled in was at Wake Forest. So it's the little quirky nugget there is John is 0-2 as Duke's coach at Wake Forest, but he's 1-0 as Duke's interim coach at Wake Forest because Kay didn't make the trip to Winston-Salem in his last season. That was John.
And that win goes to Kay, right?
Yeah, it didn't get Pete Godetted.
Okay, that's where I was going with that. So the win goes to Kay, but the losses of Pete Godet stay with Pete Godet. Just want to make that clear. So poor Pete.
There's some backstory there. I'm not going to do this justice, but there is a backstory there where like somebody has told me that Kay wanted to take those games, and there was something where somebody told him that they had to go to Pete Godet. I don't know.
I'm sure Kay really wanted those games on his record, and not Pete. I think he went out of his way.
There's so much more to that story, and it's one of those things where I know what the lore outside of Duke is. Like, I know how people outside of Duke talk about it, and I want to get inside of it, but it's just something that, like, are you ever going to get the true story of how the conversations went damn near 30 years ago?
Yeah.
Probably one of those things that's lost to, like, the myth and lost to time and translation.
Yeah, I always have to poke fun at that. But like you said, it was damn near 30 years ago. But yeah. I want to go back to the rebounding stat, Connor, because I tweeted about it before the game. But now I'm adding the game to this tweet because it goes with it. And Duke's 5 out of the last 6 games, Duke has shot 46% or better from the field. And that doesn't get talked about enough. And Duke has essentially rebounded offensively every other missed shot. So Duke had double-digit rebounds last night. I think Duke had 39 missed shots, and they had 19 offensive rebounds. I don't have it in front of me. But, oh, yeah, dude, 32 of 68. So that's 34 missed shots. So they had 19 offensive rebounds. So every other missed shot Duke got. And then
same 32 of 68 is 36 missed shots.
36 missed shots. I went to Ferrum. Look, the acceptance rate was if you had a pulse, you got in. So that, no offense to Keats. Maybe that explains why I lost against Duke. But anyways, yeah, it's now 5 of the last 6 games, Connor, that Duke has shot 46% or better from the field while also having double-digit rebounds. And I think people keep trying to find a narrative with this Duke team because they're like, wow, Duke's really starting to play good ball, but there's not like one guy on the team. And it's just like, there doesn't need to be. When a team can rebound this collectively on the glass, and that's always been the funny part, right, Connor, was Duke doesn't have a true 5. How are they going to replace Derek Lively? Well, I'll tell you, gang rebounding, and Duke does that better than any team in the country.
We're so far past the what is Duke going to do without Derek Lively part of the discussion. I know you, why you bring it up. I thought I was past that in November. I really wanted to be past it in December, and then I felt like finally in January I was past it.
Well, sorry to bring it back, but you're going to keep saying
it. No, it's good that you're bringing it up because I'm sure we're going to hear about it all over again when the rest of
– When March plays out and Duke gets matched up with whoever they play in the NCAA tournament, they're going to play against – I mean, we're really going to hear it if the one seed Duke has is Purdue. I'm like, well, how is Duke going to guard Zach Edey? And they don't have a Derek Lively. But I think we kind of saw that if they – say the Duke does play Purdue, they're matched up with them. Duke might just do what they did against NC State. Hey, Edey, you're one-on-one in the post. We'll give you 30, but nobody else is going to score as long as we're efficient on the offensive end.
Well, we're going to see that in 4 days too.
Yeah.
I mean, Baycott is a different type of post-up, low-post big than DJ Burns. Every center in the country is a different kind of low-post big than DJ Burns is, but – I think the theory will be the same. I think you just leave Filipowski in there on Baycott and whoever else you want to play in there. And if Carolina wants to throw the ball down to the post for one of the lowest efficiency plays in college basketball right now, fine, go ahead. The theory there would be, okay, Duke is at home. They're going to make more shots. They're going to be more efficient on the offensive end than you can be efficient just going two at a time.
Yeah. And I mean, obviously I would not be upset if Duke continued to double off Cadeau. Like, that's the one guy obviously Duke had success with, but I agree with you in the standpoint of like, if it's not a double off Cadeau, let it one-on-one die on the island, because I don't think this aged poorly when we did the UNC preview and I said Baycott's going to still have 20 and 10 after he was a no-show. But
yeah, don't jinx yourself into anything.
I'm going to jinx myself because I am admitting that this could be a jinx. So I'm trying to reverse psychology this thing, Connor. But I don't think he'll be as efficient from the field as he was game one, because he had a couple that – I mean, he had a banked-in shot. He hit like a 20-footer that I haven't seen him shoot in years, and it was just a weird – away game for Duke where Baycott was just in a rhythm early. And I think, look, it's going to be on the road for UNC, so they're not going to get favorable whistles in Cameron. Nobody does on the road. I mean, Duke had 14 fouls to NC State 7 or something like that last night. So it's just – it happens on the road. So I'm just saying I think Baycott's rhythm as a whole is going to be way different than at the Dean Dome.
Yeah, now that you bring that up, I'm reminded of – last year's game between UNC and Duke, Derek Lively had like three plays in the first few minutes that I looked at and was like, how is that not a foul?
Yeah.
But it wasn't a foul all game, and they clearly were going to let him play, and that's how Derek Lively wound up with what did he have, like 8 points or 6 points, 14 rebounds, 8 blocks in that game, something
like that. I don't have that in front of me, but you have a great memory, because
I remember is going through the Duke locker room afterward and asking like three players, have you ever seen a player dominate a game in which he only scored this many points and had 14 rebounds and 8 blocks? Yeah. It was just that type of game.
But, well, a guy that's come on for Duke, Connor, this year is basically Derek Lively off the bench is Sean Stewart. I mean, he had 3 blocks last night. Sean Stewart help side defense is legit, because that's where you can use his athleticism. It's just the one-on-one. Again, I did the breakdown and I posted on Twitter and my YouTube. Nobody can guard DJ Burns, but it became laughable where DJ Burns was catching the ball at the 3-point line and just he would use Sean Stewart had his forearm and full body weight on him, and Burns would spin off of that as a counter. Sean Stewart will come back and use his body weight, so Burns would spin back to go to counter that, and he did a left-handed hook shot. And I'm just like, look, Sean Stewart, there's nothing you can do about it. This guy is just different. But as a help side defender, he has some highlighted blocks and a goaltend.
That was the most obvious goaltend I've seen his last most obvious goaltend, which I think was at Louisville when he like smacked a ball that was inches away from the basket and clearly on the way down. He's fun to watch. And I mean this in the most complimentary way possible, because his energy gets him in trouble sometimes. He just bounces around so much. There were times last night watching him try to defend DJ Burns in the post, and it was like DJ Burns was moving at a slower speed, and Sean Stewart was out of position because he was moving faster than DJ Burns. Like, he was beating DJ Burns to the spot, so DJ had time to react and go the other way. It was just like, well, maybe stay in the one spot there, Sean.
Yeah, he plays – I say he always goes 85 miles an hour, and there's times in the game where he needs to go 25 like it's a school zone, but he'll just continue to go 85, and he plays like a puppy. Like, you're like, oh, like, great job, and then he just continues to be a puppy behavior and just running around, has the zoomies, and gets in trouble sometimes. But the one play, Connor, before – in the first half, he almost had that poster dug. That ESPN didn't replay it. I'm like, you got to show me this replay, because he can jump, but damn, he almost flushed that.
Me and my buddy Rod Baxley, who works for the Fayetteville newspaper, we have a running joke now that Sean Stewart tries one life-altering dunk per game. Like, he gets in there, and he just tries to end people. Like, he gets one per game, just about. Mm-hmm.
He's a freak.
He's probably gonna land one at some point.
Oh, what if he lands one in Cameron? Oh, my. Like, on Saturday?
Yeah.
That place, that roof's going to blow. Yeah.
Yep.
And, look, he led Duke. You know, I'm big in plus-minus. He led Duke in plus-minus at plus 20 in 26 minutes. Like, the guy put it together in a huge road win for Duke.
Season-high 26 minutes. The first game he's had all year with 3 blocks. He'd been at 2 a couple times. I had a freelancer with me last night, Max Rigo. Duke graduate from last year, and I got to know him through his work on the Chronicle, and he wrote a great story for me on Sean Stewart. Just, he's kept coming on strong. And I would add in, I did a radio appearance with Adam Gold, and the story I told was, you're seeing his confidence develop. Like, you see his confidence develop. I think it was the Boston College game when he made those two little mini, they weren't really hook shots, but they're also not like jumpers. Yeah, they're just kind of like, he made two of them, I think, late in the first half against Boston College. He made another one or two of those last night. That's where you see confidence in himself paying off. I think the bigger thing is his teammates have more confidence in him over the last couple of weeks.
Yeah.
And that comes from John playing him more, but it also comes from him being in the right places. And yeah, I think back to, I can't remember what game it was, but he came up for a Tyrese Proctor dribble handoff and instead tried to screen and had Tyrese Proctor walk into a turnover, and Tyrese Proctor stood there and just dressed him down in the middle of Cameron. You're not seeing that as much. And I go to the Virginia game. This is another benefit of sitting courtside at these games. Sean Stewart was open on a lob, and Tyrese didn't hit him. Just kept dribbling at the top of the key, and he might not have had the passing lane. He might not have seen him. I don't know why it didn't get to Sean, but he had a clear path to the basket. It's just throw it anywhere near the basket, and it's an easy 2 points. And like the ball got pushed to the other side of the court. I think Duke scored on the possession, but after Tyrese got the ball out of his hands, he like gave a hands up and was like apologizing to Sean Stewart in the middle of the play for missing him. You contrast that with cussing him out in the middle of the court. Like Filipowski had a moment earlier this year where Sean Stewart knocked a defensive rebound out of his hand. I think it was Clemson got a bucket or Pitt got a bucket while Filipowski was screaming at him on the defensive end. You're not seeing that as much. Like their trust in Sean Stewart is growing, which is helping John's confidence in Sean Stewart grow, and which is helping Sean's confidence in Sean Stewart grow.
Yeah.
That's why you're getting the version of him that you're seeing in the last couple games.
Yeah, the encouraging part about Sean Stewart this whole season is the growth, like you said, but also he'll make a mistake every game, but then the following game he doesn't make the same mistake. Like,
yeah.
It's like learn from your mistakes, he does it right away. And I clipped this also on Twitter of the video breakdown for the State game. It was against UVA. Sean Stewart gets the ball and is starting to run in transition, but he wanted to be the point forward instead of finding a guard. And Duke's up 25 at the time, and he dribbles off his foot, goes right to Virginia. Virginia gets a layup, but the game's basically over. I think that cut the lead to 25. Fast forward to last night, Filipowski knocks the ball away from State, lands right to Sean Stewart to start a fast break. Instead of trying to dribble it and to be a point forward like the game prior, he finds Roach immediately. And though it leads to a Proctor miss layup and then a miss Sean Stewart tip-in, it comes back out to the play of the game, which McCain hits a four-point play to basically ice the whole game. So Sean Stewart learned from a mistake that he had against Virginia and a part of the game that did not matter to basically leading the biggest play of the night for Duke, a four-point play by McCain. And that's winning basketball, is when you have a role player knowing his role to find the guard.
Yeah, and that's – look, I mean, how much have we talked this year about role definition and how Duke didn't have it for a lot of the year? Like, we were waiting on role definition like this, and here it is. Like, that's it. It's come. Like, people understand their roles.
He had 12 points, Connor, but take points away. Say he had 0 points. These are the stats that I love as a post player, especially off the bench. 3 blocks, like you said, 2 steals, and then 4 offensive rebounds.
Yeah.
That's perfect. That's perfect play from a guy in the post, especially coming off the bench.
Yeah. Yep. And doing enough, like forcing enough turnovers. I don't think he gets credit for the steal on the turnover right in front of Duke's bench at the end of the first half, but he certainly caused a turnover there.
Mm-hmm.
That's more of what you need out of him.
100%. And I want to go, this is going to tie all back around, Connor, because the plus minus that he had 20, 5 guys at Duke, 4 Duke were plus 10. The worst was Mark Mitchell at -4, but Mitchell had 4 offensive rebounds. He did things, but it explains kind of he only played 18 minutes because Sean Stewart was playing so well and Ryan Young was playing well. So it's just one of those nights. But then that goes to two of your stats, Connor, that I want you to talk about. Duke has the overall record when Mark Mitchell scores in double figures and when he doesn't. He did not score in double figures last night. And then Duke's record when they do and don't assist on half of their made baskets, which they did not last night. And so you don't have to give me the exact numbers because I see you trying
to me trying to do the math in my head right now.
Yeah, but basically what I'm saying, what I'm getting to is it's impressive that Duke was 0-2 and stats where Duke's elite when those things are achieved. Duke's 17-0 or 18-0 whenever they have half assist on or half of their made baskets are assisted on. And then like 30-3 when Mark Mitchell scores in double figures. And they're basically average when both those things don't happen. And Duke, that happened last night. And Duke won on the road at a place where they don't win on the road without those two things coexisting. Just a remarkable game for Duke.
Off the top of my head, it's 32-3 when Mark Mitchell scores in double figures. It's now, I think, 17-10 or it might be up to 18 and 10 when he scores in single figures. The assist one, I know. 17 and 0 when above 50%. 7 and 6 now when 50% or lower in assist rate. The one that you didn't bring up that we should, rebounding this year, they're 19 and 1 when out rebounding their opponent.
I did not know that. I should have known that because I keep giving all these offense rebounding stats, so I should have looked into that more. But yes, that is a great stat for me because, I mean, that's the – when I always look at box scores, I try not look at individual performance of points, rebounds, assists. I like to look at team, either if it's turnovers or if it's rebounding, and then if it's rebounding, then I go to offense rebounding because that's the story of the game. And that's why I see 47% from the field and 19 offensive rebounds. And he shot 62% in the second half. Like, those things correlate, and that correlates to winning. And Duke has played their best basketball. This is back-to-back years, Connor. Duke's played their best basketball, like, at the end of the season. Shire just progresses.
That's the – as much of a calling card as a second-year, I think, 36-year-old head coach can have, John's calling card is the fact that both of his teams have gotten progressively better and played better in December than they did in November, played better in January than the first 2 months, played better in February than they did the previous three. We're two games into March, so it's a little hard to say right now, but this team right now through two games, and if you want to take late February into account, they're playing their best basketball right now. Like, even with the Wake loss, like, that was a loss in a hostile environment, and it was a down-to-the-wire, blow-for-blow game. It's not like they went in there and got waxed by 15. They're playing their best basketball when it matters the most. And that's – look, man, like, this is the point that I made in part of the story last night. Like, that's kind of what you want when you have a team that's as young as Duke is. And that was the case last year, especially last year with basically Jeremy Roach, Ryan Young, Jacob Grandison, and a bunch of freshmen. Mm-hmm. It's a little less the case this year, but you still have to remember Duke is on the very young side of experience. Like, as good as last year was for Kyle Filipowski, Proctor, and Mitchell, they're still sophomores. They're still only played in, what is it now, 50-some or 60-some games. Yeah. It's not like they're RJ Davis or Armando Bacot who are going to go through senior night tonight and one of them can come back next year. Armando Bacot, I think just became the all-time leader in games played in ACC history.
Well, yeah, no shit. I mean, he's played for 10 years.
I mean, you know who he passed.
Yeah, God, they said on the broadcast, Oh, yeah, K. Clark.
Yeah.
He was also at Virginia for like 6 years.
So it's still a young Duke team, and young teams, you don't look at young teams and think they're going to be world class in November and December. Like, there are exceptions to that rule. The Zion year, the Kentucky National Championship with Anthony Davis. Like, those are the exceptions to that.
Yeah,
young teams don't do that. The young teams, you want them to stay on the upward trajectory and you want them to be good now. You're not asking them to be great and execute everything to the T in early January when you're playing at Boston College in front of 8,000 people.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I've said this, I've probably beat this dead horse too many times, but like the Zion year, it's great they won the first game against Kentucky because Kentucky is a blue blood rival by a million points, but that was the best game of the season for Duke besides the ACC tournament game against UNC. But they, in March, like in the tournament, I forgot who they played first. They were down late in the first half and they finally pulled away late. I think it was like South Dakota State maybe or something like that.
Almost North Dakota State.
North Dakota State. And then round of 32, was that UCF?
Got really lucky to be
lost that game.
Dawkins and Taco Fall.
That I still don't know how that tipping didn't go in. And then I don't know how the tipping didn't go in for Virginia Tech at the end of that game. And so point being is like this team is different. Shire has won now with two different types of teams. Last year's team, there's one three-point shooter on the team you could confidently say, and that was Derek Whitehead, who turned it on in the second half of the year. Lively was not a scoring threat until the second half of the year, where they could start throwing lobs to him, but that was about it. He was a defensive force.
He also had no shot attempts in their last – in the NCAA tournament loss.
Well, see, there you go. And now he plays with Luka, and he's just catching it at the rim every time, because that's what happens when you don't have defensive 3 seconds in the league. But don't let me go down that road. And but now with Duke, like, they can score – like, the guards – anybody can get hot from three from Duke. Like, yeah. McCain, Rhodes shooting 50%, and TJ Powers coming along to where he can steal a couple threes in the tournament. Like, he plays his 10 minutes now because, look, Caleb Foster, that scares me with his injury, because the way that it's – he is, it looks more like a fracture than it is a sprain. But I won't go any further than that. I just look from my naked eye and from experience, it looks like it's more of a type of like a broken bone in his foot type of thing rather than a sprained ankle.
Here's the way I would phrase it with Caleb Foster is we've seen three games without Caleb Foster, and I think all three games have shown kind of the silver lining in the glass half full of when you're down a guy, you have guys step up, and I'm not going to say Duke is better without Caleb Foster. I do think their role definition is a little more clear, and it's forced John to go deeper into some lineups that, if you want to argue, Duke should have been playing the three-guard lineups and like having Kyle Filipowski play more of the four and Mark Mitchell play more of the three back in January and early February. I'm not going to argue with you. I think it's kind of silly because I'm not in practice. Like, John's the one in practice. John's the one that makes the rotations based on not just who's doing what in games. But I will say, like, we have not seen a downside of Caleb Foster's injury yet, and I think that's coming. Like, I think there's going to be – there's bound to be a game, whether it's Saturday or whether it's in D.C., as long as he doesn't come back, which I really doubt he's back for the Carolina game. I kind of doubt he's back next week. Like, I think NCAA tournament is the only realistic chance right now. I think there's going to be a game where you say, man, they really miss Caleb Foster. That's bound to happen. Just the nature of it. Like, you're not going to go down a guy that averages, what, 25 minutes a game and is capable of scoring the way he does and not get to a point where you say, shit, we miss this guy. We need him out there.
What's going to burn Duke right there, and where I think in this hypothetical will be foul trouble by two guards. And then Shai is going to have to play power even either too much on the wing where he's not a ball handler and it can be sort of disastrous, or Blake's gives you no offense when he comes in the game. And so that I could see that like happening. I know Shire and them have a game plan for the inevitable when that happens. But, yeah, right now they're clicking on all cylinders. But this is probably like 35% of the games this season, 40% of the games this season. Duke's missing like one of their six players. I don't have it in front of me, but it sounds about right that it's at least double-digit games now where Duke's missed like a Filipowski, a Mitchell, a Proctor, McCain, Roach, and Foster.
Yeah, I think we just got to double digits here. Three without Caleb. They is basically four without Proctor. They missed Mitchell for two. And then Tyrese missed the additional game with concussion last month.
So that's 10 right there, roughly. And then three now by Foster.
I thought I said Foster at the beginning of that.
Oh, you did.
Yeah. Roach, though. Roach missed, what, one game? One or two. I know he missed the Pitt game. And then he came back for Louisville. He missed the Pitt game, came back for Louisville, and re-aggravated it. And then was back in there, but not himself. But he still plays. It's funny to watch. He's the one guy on the team that can convince John to leave him in the game with two fouls. John will take you to the bench after your second foul, and you'll sit there for a while, and maybe he'll put you back in. Jeremy Roach is the only one who can pick up his second foul and immediately start telling John on the bench, "I'm good, I'm good, I'm good, I'm good," and John will leave him in the game.
Seniority, baby. I mean, it plays because John knows, like, if he picks up his third, that he can mother F him going to the bench. Like, I told you to get out of the game. And and Roach would respond positively in that, because he was not going to fold. John holds the senior guard to the highest standard, as it should be. And then I think Flip is probably second right there on who he can jump on the hardest.
Based on what John says, he can jump on Jared pretty hard.
Oh yeah, McCain too, because McCain loved, like, I think I remember John saying that he thrives on like that. Like, he responds very well.
Yeah, he's made no secrets about Jared being able to be coached really hard. Like, I think that's word for word. He has said, you can coach Jared hard, which to me is like Shire. That's Shireism of, yeah, I can dog the shit out of this guy and he's still going to make like his next four threes if he gets hot. He's not going to go pout in the corner.
And look, like I've said too on social media, there's a difference between TikTok McCain and basketball McCain, because basketball McCain loves that environment. He loves the toxicity that comes playing on the road wearing Duke across his chest. He's not just the singing and dancing guy you see. That guy is looking to talk shit, and I love when he does.
Yeah, he's third on the rung for shit talkers on the team. Nobody touches Jeremy and Tyrese.
No. Well, I mean, Roach is from D.C., right?
Yeah. One of them hit a three in front of State's bench in the first half last night and was turned and barking at somebody deep on the – like, it was walk-on and 12th man territory that they were barking at. And it's like, all right, I guess they said some shit.
I love that environment. But Roach makes sense, number one. He's from D.C. That dude – those guys talk hella shit. So that does not surprise me one bit. But, Connor, brother, another episode done, completed. So now we will wait until the outcome of Duke Carolina Saturday, Duke Redemption. Now, lastly, end on this, because do you know the situation where Duke can win the ACC? Is it if Clemson beats Wake Forest that holds the tiebreaker? If Duke beats UNC? I should have asked this earlier, but do you know?
It all comes down to who finishes fourth. There's four teams that can finish in fourth place right now. Where Virginia is in third does not matter, because both Duke and Carolina have the same record against Virginia. So you have to keep going down the standings to find the next team that they have a different record against. And I think every team that could finish fourth, they have different records against. For Duke's purposes, Duke wants to obviously win Saturday's game. And then Duke wants either Clemson or Syracuse, who play tonight, Tuesday night, like in less than 4 hours. Duke needs one of those two. Both of them they went 1-0 against, and both of them beat Carolina. If one of them gets the tiebreak for fourth place, then Duke gets the number one seed. If it's Pitt or Wake, I think Carolina didn't lose to Pitt or Wake, and Duke did. So if it's Pitt or Wake in that fourth place spot, then a tie means Duke is the two seed and Carolina is the one seed.
Got it. Good Lord. This sounds like ACC Coastal chaos right now. Ending.
I mean, you say that now. Next year it's an 18-team league.
Yeah.
So you can just – and there's going to be less head-to-heads because you're only going to play three teams twice. It's just going to be a cluster. We're going to need – I've been referring to the middle of the league for a couple years as an amorphous blob. I'm going to need to come up with a different term, because it's just – it's going to be way too many teams bunched up and, you know. But we'll cross that bridge when we get to it.
Yeah, so obviously there's a lot of moving parts from today until next time we record. So we could either be recapping a second-place Duke team or a first-place Duke team by next Tuesday.
Root for the orange teams is basically the easiest thing I can tell you, even though they play each other. So one's going to lose and one's going to win tonight.
Well, Connor, I appreciate you breaking that down for me, because I genuinely did not know. And I know the listeners did not know either. So thank you for breaking it down to us. And I'll see you next Tuesday to recap Duke and UNC.
Sounds good.